HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Pete and Alice in Maine, a novel by Caitlin Shetterly, performed by Eileen Stevens, Joe Knezevich, and Sarah Naughton.
For My Mimi, 1927 to 2022. To have been loved so deeply, even though the person who loved us is gone, will give us some protection forever. J.K. Rowling, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. And for my husband, Dan, who found time for me when there was none to find. All that June, the weather had mocked the maple's internal misery with solid sunlight. John Updike, Separating. I used to believe in happiness. I did not understand that we never fully arrive in that universe. We visit for miraculous moments and then travel all the other universes. Meredith Hall, Beneficence.
1. Visible Holes. I'm not sure why this all appeals to me. Maybe I am intrinsically a lazy person, and having a small circumference of space in which to tread and retread is somehow satisfyingly comforting. Maybe I like doing away with grocery shopping. Well, honestly, I hate grocery shopping and ferrying my children to dance and piano and basketball. And smiling at other mothers I have nothing in common with. Maybe I like having those bastards at Amazon deliver my olive oil and flour and instant oatmeal and stamp pads for my youngest daughter, Iris, to stamp rainbows and moons all over the bathroom walls, which makes Pete yell, and then me yell, and then Iris cries while Sophie says something caustic to all of us. Maybe I like the feeling of being on an arc that, at least for now, has no visible holes. Maybe I like things simple, confined. Or maybe it's just that this way my husband can't leave me. But anyway, we came up here to escape, to shelter. I have expected armed guards at the border, not letting us across the Piscataqua Bridge. I thought we'd have to swim, or go back, or get stuck in New Hampshire forever. We'd be forced to live free or die. But there were no guards. Just a quiet I-95 and the sign, "Welcome Home." Is this our home? It's our second home in July and August. We pay taxes. And I certainly enjoy the gray shingled simplicity of our low cape and the thick, bristly lawn around it. The waves hitting the orangey pink granite rocks at the end of our yard. And then the ocean beyond roaring through stormy nights. But until now, it wasn't home, really. We called New York home. This was just another appendage of our luck, this place. And it still is. But like Job's messengers, we got out. That isn't the important part of why I am telling you this, though. I took a writing workshop in Saratoga one summer, taught by a writer named Lee K. Abbott. He's dead now. Doesn't surprise me. Guy was a drinker and smoker, and to be around him was like playing with a top that's spinning out of control in the most extraordinary and exciting way. He wrote one of the best first lines to his story. I don't remember the name of that story now, but I'll never forget his words. I would not want to be one of those memoirists who begin a recollection by saying, "Attention, people, there's a dead dog in these pages." But alas, I am, and there is. When I start writing a story, or when I used to back before, I think, where's my dead dog? Should I tell them about the dead dog? Anyway, that's not important either. Sorry, I'm digressing. Our privilege is clear, almost criminal. I am reminded over and over of this fact as Iris screeches about Sophie stealing a Lego and then hits her. And Sophie pushes her back against the hardwood floor. and Pete raises his voice, and doors get slammed, and then pancakes still somehow appear on our breakfast table for us all to enjoy, even if both girls have sour expressions on their faces. We are here. We can shelter together. We can drive each other crazy. We don't need personal protective equipment. No one is counting on us to save their lives. We must only save our own. That is the story. We got here late at night on a Wednesday. Schools had closed. It was already bad. Panic had seeped into every corner of the city. And in the evenings, the rats were out, moving like gray-black shadows through the eerily empty streets. Getting into the elevator felt like walking into a war zone. Picking up the mail was dangerous, maybe suicidal. New Yorkers were all scared of one another. For those few odd days when we waited for the tsunami, but our lives still went on and school was still open, I was scared of my own children. I was scared of Pete coming home from work. I didn't want him touching me or the girls in case he had it. Every throat clearing or sniffle elicited a code orange. "We can leave," I told Pete the Sunday before we did. We were in bed. It was after midnight. Not since 9/11 had I heard ambulances punctuating the night like this. I couldn't read. I couldn't leave the bed. I couldn't sleep. The sound had me frozen in some sort of PTSD time warp. "We don't have to stay." "You want to go to your parents?" he asked. I could tell he meant just me and the girls. He'd stay and man the fort. Stoic as this was of him, we females would go to Minneapolis and hunker down, he was thinking. "No, Maine," I said. "The house is shut down," he countered. "I know. And it's still cold. We have no way of heating it. We've used that fireplace in the living room. Why, once? And the whole house filled with smoke. The pipes will freeze once we get the water on. We'll buy an electric heater or two. Look at the map on the time site. They don't have any COVID up there." "Or any that they know about. The testing, Alice, it's bullshit." "We should go. It's safer." "I still have my job." "Yes, the job. The problem of the job. The job that has supported us and allowed me to be a mother and chief officer of the calendar and the laundry and the spare clothes bags for school and all the camp forms and all the doctor's visits while Pete works. The job that gives me time to try to be a writer when the girls are in school. If I can think of something to write with a few brain cells I have left from being a mother. The time I used to fill notebooks with endless ideas for plays and stories and novels and TV shows. Stacks and stacks and stacks of them that never get opened again and end up in a vinyl bin under our bed. The job that makes our money and is the thing, especially since number two, that ties us back together over and over again. Ever since he began, the other thing. Tell them you'll work remotely. The country is headed for financial disaster. They'll need me here. They might not need you at all, Pete. Silence. A mode he slides into effortlessly, with no idea that the girls and I are dangling on the other end of a rope. It can mean anger, or sometimes just not knowing what to say. Sometimes he's just vanished. Where he goes in silence scares me. Then, after such a long wait that I thought he'd gone to sleep, he said, "We have no internet up there." Right. I anticipated this. The problem of the internet. No internet was my requirement when we bought the main place. When Pete was on the rise, and I could see I was losing him to the constant demands of his job. To the screen always in front of him, the Bluetooth in his ear, even at dinner. It's funny. What had initially compelled me to him, as soon as we'd had Sophie, became that which I wanted to excise from our lives. His hustling, trading, fast-talking, advice-giving, market-playing self. It was that person to whom the other men gave fist bumps when we arrived at a party. that smiling, confident energy that made other wives flirt with him. That person who talked deals all the way through a workout with his trainer at Equinox. That was my guy who got us to the front of the line at Nami Nori on a Thursday night. Pete is magnetic, hard to resist, and exciting. The very qualities I thought would carry us both, fueled on his energy alone, into a life of success. But when Sophie came, I got stuck. I wanted to make cookies like my mother used to. I wanted to make forts out of cardboard boxes and take long walks in Riverside Park and wear sweats all day. I still wanted to write. But the career I'd been slowly building with a poem in a journal here, a story in another journal there, one little three-person off-Broadway play that got a notice in a longer review of 10 young New York City playwrights to watch in the New York Times no longer felt imperative. Everything I'd learned in college and in the acting, playwriting, and directing classes I'd taken all over New York City, and what I'd learned just in rewriting and rewriting again, seemed to slide into the mush of the compost bin. Days, and then months passed in the time it seemed to take for me to change a diaper. I could no longer triage my own thoughts, let alone my own needs. Me didn't even make the list. When we went to parties or took an Uber out to Brooklyn to eat at Red Hook Tavern, even if I'd put on my nicest dress, slimmest jeans, or sparkliest shirt, I often felt out of step with Pete. In my mind, I still had spit up in my hair. I was still changing diapers and nursing. I wanted to be home with Sophie. I wanted to feel her soft skin and buttery smell. I wanted her hot cheek pressed against my neck, her drool dampening my collar. I wanted to go home and pry her from the arms of the nanny whom I came only to resent. It's such a tired story. But by the time I'd fired the nanny and required that our house in Maine be an oasis from everything in New York that was slowly swallowing my soul, Pete and I were no longer going clickety-clack down the same straight-line track. Our tracks merged for the girls, for the convenience of our lives, and we continued on. While I spent years of money and time in therapy trying to figure out how unhappy I really was and how much I loved him, and whether I'd be truer to my most authentic self if I were able to leave him. Not because he did anything too terribly wrong that I knew of, until he did. It was the feeling all the time that he might, or might have already, or that maybe I might, who knew? But I never got beyond just that one agonizing question. Should I? I was perpetually treading water. I'd lost my way in the world. Gosh, had I disappeared for a moment like he does? Yes, it was the internet issue we were talking about. We can install it, Pete. We will have to. And until they come, you can go to the library in town. Your phone and iPad will work in the field. The whatever that is up in the sky that makes things like that work will work, I said. It's the cellular network. Right, that. Silence again. When do you want to leave, Alice? Now, tomorrow. That's nuts. There's no way we can get us all out of here by tomorrow. It might not even be that bad. Right now might be the worst. We can sit this out. It's going to be that bad. We need to go. The girls. I'm taking them. What I didn't say, and he knew, was, you need to choose. My stuckness was unsticking. Action was rumbling inside me for the first time in years. When he agreed, he wasn't choosing me. You get to a place in a marriage and you know that. He was choosing our girls, our black cat Ingmar, and our shiny car all over me. He was choosing the house in Maine over me, paid for by his gains while others lost during the Great Recession a decade ago, when being on the side that wasn't free-falling was a criminal advantage. You'll need to pack us up, was all he said. And then we lay there drifting in and out, listening to sirens alternate with silence, unable to turn to each other. I don't know what they worked out for him. He said he was going to work from home. He'd use his phone and computer to manage his guys, analyze numbers, assess risks, send the bank's president his projections, lean in and away from trades, and pull strings that would affect the entire country, or world even, just with the invisible wand he'd wave on his laptop. Did he tell the her he was going? Did he say goodbye? Were there five of us, or more to the point, the germs of five times whatever other contacts we five had been exposed to in the car when we left? 50 people, could it be? More? Does anyone know? The sun was mocking us when we drove up the Hudson and north. As if this were all a figment of our imaginations. Life was just fine. Smile and go back home, the sunlight glinting on the river seemed to insist. When we got in the car, I'd said, "We won't stop, girls. You each have a jar back there to pee in if it gets desperate. When we get farther out, we'll stop on the side of the road."
"What if I need to poop?"
asked my 5-year-old Iris, her brown hair falling straight and soft, like a pelt, and framing either side of her pointy white face, her green and copper-flecked eyes trained on mine.
"You'll try to hold it," Pete said,
his hands gripping the steering wheel tightly. His knuckles cracked dry from so much sanitizer and hand washing. Something about his dry hands steering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.